So Hamiltonian systems. These are also based around a scalar function. I'll call it H, Hamiltonian. So this scalar function H, maybe it's easier if we just write it as scalar function of X and Y. So again, think of a height function, but we're not going to just take the gradient. We'll do something else. A Hamiltonian system is one where X dot equals partial H partial Y and Y dot equals negative partial H partial X. So any system where you have this would be called a two-dimensional Hamiltonian system. There is a relationship with the gradient here. So suppose I have some, I'll make a bowl-shaped function over here. Got some contours, got a minimum point. This is H, and then we've got X and Y. If we were to plot what the contours look like, got contours of this and down here in the XY plane, this will be a curve. This other thing will project a curve. So we're plotting here level sets of the H function. What if we were to plot the gradient? The gradient of H of components partial X, partial H partial X and partial H partial Y. The gradient is always pointing outward of these level sets. Maybe less so at the inner one. How is this related to the system of ODEs we've written over here? It looks like we've taken the gradient and then switched some things and put in a minus sign. Well, yeah, we have. What we've done, if we were to write this in vector form, it looks like X dot Y dot equals 0, 1, negative 1, 0. So we've got this matrix in front of the gradient. Partial H, partial X, partial H, partial Y. This matrix is equivalent to a 90 degree turn clockwise. What does that mean? 90 degree turn clockwise, take any of these vectors over here on the right, the gradients, and we'll be rotating by 90 degrees. That's what is going on here in these red vectors. So I'm plotting the vector field given by this system up here. It's the gradient, but rotated. Sometimes it's been called the skew gradient. But what it means, because you'll notice when you've got level sets of H, the gradient is normal to it. But then if you rotate 90 degrees, you've got vectors that are actually along level sets of H. So the nice thing about Hamiltonian systems is once you've plotted the level sets of H, trajectories will actually follow the level sets. So if I were to plot this in some different way, X and Y, and maybe plot one of these contours. The vector field is always tangent to the level set. So if you start on a level set, the trajectory just wants to stay on a level set. And so these level sets tend to be closed curves. So it's like we get periodic orbits everywhere almost, except for these degenerate points, bottom of the height function. And I plotted a particularly simple height function. You could have other kinds of height functions that have all kinds of different dynamics. I guess for good measure, I'll throw in the other kind of inside thing. So we could easily just draw the arrows on these curves because all level sets are trajectories. We're talking about two-dimensional Hamiltonian systems. Periodic orbits are possible and rather generic. I mean, we could plot different kinds of functions and get other things. Here's one. So if this was H, what's being plotted here as the black curves are level sets of this interesting function H that seems to kind of peak at two points, but then it has some wells. It's got a saddle point in red. I'll show this saddle point. So you can literally just read off from the level sets of H what the trajectories will be. That's a nice thing about it. And you might be wondering, well, where do these kind of things show up? If you've studied fluid mechanics, 2D incompressible flow. Sometimes they don't say they're Hamiltonian systems, but common 2D Hamiltonian system comes from fluids. 2D incompressible fluids, where H is called the stream function, and it's usually given a different symbol. Usually write it as psi. So if we have psi is some function of X and Y, X dot is partial psi partial Y, and Y dot is negative partial psi partial X, and this describes the fluid velocity that fluid particles take. So often when you've seen a stream function, you may have seen a stream function when weather is being described. They'll show often closed curves and the stream function, 2D fluid flows will be along level sets of the stream function. And the stream function can do interesting things. Maybe there's some kind of saddle point type behavior and other things going on. And here, yeah, you could have fixed points. You could have, just like any Hamiltonian system, there could be saddle points. It turns out that you can have fixed points anywhere for a Hamiltonian system. Or you're like, what's that all about? Because once we restrict to a particular type of system, you can't just have fixed points anywhere. But when we've got Hamiltonian systems, or think of, you know, stream function type systems, you can have fixed points anywhere. But they're only of two types, only centers and saddles. And that's it. There are no points that are asymptotically stable. So there's no places where things spiral in. And there's no points where everything's spiraling out. So there's no unstable or stable spirals, no unstable or stable nodes, only centers and saddles. And we can say something about why. The clue is kind of here when I said you could describe incompressible fluids this way. So what does it mean to describe incompressible fluids? An incompressible 2D fluid means that if you start with a fluid patch, and I'll even draw on a little fluid patch maybe here. If you start with a rectangular patch of fluid that has a certain volume, 2D volume, which we also call area. So if you have some initial area, then this thing will evolve and maybe it'll get stretched in some directions. So here it is at some later time. This is the area at some other time. And maybe other things happen. But the area, the actual area, can't change. A at any time is going to be equal to A at the initial time. Area at any later time will be area of the initial time for a finite-sized blob of fluid. No matter how convoluted things get, it has to maintain area. That's what makes this incompressible. Probably seen some examples of stream functions. Here's a stream function of flow around a cylinder. Just the common version of stream functions. So there's flow around a cylinder, right? There's special points here, stagnation points that just run right into the cylinder and then go off of it. Here are some stream functions related to point vortices. So I don't know what these different cases are. This is just from a paper about fluid mechanics. And then here's a stream function around an airfoil. And this is supposed to be describing how air parcels will move around. If I was able to draw on this, ooh, I am able to draw. That's cool. So things will just sort of move around. Ooh. And okay, there's special stagnation points. And I don't know what's going on here. But nearly everywhere, things are just moving along these constant contours, isocontours of the stream function. And that's the appeal, is you could show in one image what the stream function level sets are, and that reveals how fluid particles are moving. Sometimes they don't show the arrows, and arrows are helpful for knowing the general direction things are going. But now, Hamiltonian systems are actually defined in higher dimensions than just two, but that would take another course. So I'm just talking about two-dimensional Hamiltonian systems. Plus, you'll notice, like we have throughout this course, we're ignoring any dependence on time. For the actual stream function, for the weather, that thing changes with time, right? That's why we get weather. But here we're saying, no, this is just the stream function independent of time. So this describes steady fluid flow. That's why we've got no time dependence. Time dependence makes things a little bit more challenging. It's still useful. Keep this in mind, we can have fixed points anywhere, but only centers and saddles. And maybe you're asking, well, why only centers and saddles? It does follow from this incompressibility. And where does incompressibility, what does that mean? Usually we write the fluid flow as a vector U. So what if we write this as X dot and Y dot? and then plug in what they are, partial psi, partial y, negative partial psi, partial x. To be incompressible, you need the divergence of the fluid flow to be zero. So the divergence of the velocity field u, how do we calculate that? It's partial x of x dot, let me just put in x dot, plus partial y dot partial y. That's the divergence for 2D fluid flow. And now we just plug in what we have for x dot and y dot. So we've got second derivative of psi with respect to x and y minus second derivative of psi with respect to x and y. What do you know? It's zero. So Hamiltonian systems naturally are divergence free. And that it's that divergence free that means that viewed as a fluid, it's incompressible. But this same property applies even if we're not technically dealing with a fluid. You could just mathematically think of it as a fluid. So if you have something that's divergence free, that means if you have a fixed point, let's call this x star, things are either just circulating around it, because you could have that and have the area maintain. So a blob will just sort of go around and remain a blob of the same area. Or you could have a saddle point, in which case, if you have some blob that's initially on this stable eigendirection, it'll get stretched out. What you can't have is something spiraling in or going out. Why is that? Because then you would need that some blob starting with a certain area, the area keeps getting smaller and smaller and smaller and smaller. You just can't get that in a divergence-free flow. So maybe we put a big slash through this. Not possible. It's not possible for Hamiltonian systems. It's not possible for anything that any system that is divergence-free. Okay.